Walking for the first time in St. Francis was pretty scary, I have to say at first. So I came first with Monsignor. I was invited to come for a little visit. And when Mark Hilty started showing us campus and all the buildings and the facilities and all the things that are here in the parish, I felt a little overwhelmed by the whole thing. Now walking into a parish this size again was scary at first, and during COVID times it was actually like an unknown territory for me. I never been at St. Francis, like assigned as a seminarian before, and I didn't know Monsignor Clay either. So, but actually, you know, coming to this place and being with Monsignor Clay was a great relief, because Monsignor had some experience with seminarians before, with formation, and I was assured by many priests and friends that Monsignor Clay was going to help me and, you know, take care of me in a sense. They say that the first 2 years for a priest are critical. And if you make those first years, you're more likely to succeed and to continue, you know, pursuing your vocation and working hard. Again, it was scary at first, but Monsignor made it easy. The people here made it easy. They welcomed us and just, you know, accompanied us. I won't say that, yeah. I have learned many things during these 2 years at St. Francis. I will say one of those is to work as a team, to work as a member of a team, and to work collaboratively with people in the parish. To value the work that the lady do in the parish and the role of the lady in the church. I think that's essential, and that was one of the greatest teaching experiences here in the parish. I've learned of the great value of like this spirit of, you know, we have a lot of volunteers in this parish. We have a lot of ministries in this parish. And I love, absolutely love how people step up in the game, and if there is need, people are going to be there to support you. That desire to work. Another thing that I absolutely love about this parish and I have learned is the love that there is for many aspects in the life of the church, but especially those related to justice, especially in working for those marginalized in our society, in our cities, in the church, and how this community of faith has really embraced that aspect of our Catholicity and make it so brightly that even within the Catholic Diocese of Raleigh, we are known for the work that we do here. So that's something I truly love about this community, and the community has taught me. Oh, I will take the many faces and smiles of the people of St. Francis. I will take with me the warmth of the children, our students here, both in the preschool and just the TFS, the Franciscan school, along with the children who come to our faith formation programs. There is such warmth in their faces and in their smiles, and there's a lot of honesty. I will take that with me. I will take with me the desire to make the church a place that welcomes people always, that encourages people in their journeys of faith, that challenges people as well to become better disciples and followers of the Lord. That's something that I will treasure forever. St. Francis is like the first love for me. It will be like the first love. I will never forget it. The members of this community of faith will be in my heart always. I'll always, always remember St. Francis. Another aspect that I will take with me to the new parish in Edenton, again, it touches a little bit with the previous question, but is that that openness and that sense of being a community that welcomes people in this journey of faith, that we all are part of it. The work with migrants, and that's something that I'm looking forward to maybe implement and look at St. Francis on how we have done things here and how I can take that to the new parish community. There are some workers who come on different seasons and work in the surrounding areas in Edenton, and I hope that as a community of faith, we will be ready and willing to minister to their needs, both, you know, physical, temporal, and spiritual. So one of the fondest memories of for me here at St. Francis while I was here was actually a conversation I had with a little child, a little friend that I have here in the parish. And when we were saying goodbye, he actually came to me and said, "Thank you for being our priest." And this is a child that maybe 4 years old. It's just a small child. But listening to those honest words, it just moved me almost to tears, I have to say. I was overwhelmed by that. And, you know, in a child that age, there's just pure innocence, and they're a gift from God. I'll take what he said to me. He said, "Thank you for being our father. Thank you for being our priest." And those words mean a lot to me, because I like when people call me Father Jairo. I like that because they remind me of my vocation, of my call in my life. I'm a father. I'm a spiritual father. And when people say that to me, my goodness, I am reminded of why I chose the path I chose in life and why I answered this vocation and what I'm called to do in this vocation, you know, which is to help spread the kingdom of God, to help other people know about Him, knowing that all fatherhood comes from God, and you know the gift that He is to us. And that's, you know, one of those fondest memories I will take forever. I will treasure those words very much. The second one, it's you know, the moments we had at the rectory with Monsignor Clay and Kong and Father Jim. We had lots of good memories, but I forever will treasure, you know, a conversation I had with Monsignor Clay, in which he was, you know, we were talking about, you know, the day, how things are just going in the parish, and we were talking about, you know, something that had happened in the parish. I cannot just, you know, disclose that over here, but Monsignor was sharing with me how in a pastoral way you could answer to that need, that situation. Because the first, you know, impulse, the first thing you want to say is, well, this is what we have to do, and this is what it's written in the books, and this is how we should do it. But pastorally, how should we address this situation? And Monsignor Clay gave me a beautiful lesson of how, you know, yes, it is important and we need to be faithful to what the church, you know, is asking of us. But how, when that is true, we need to bring the people to a place in which where they can understand, you know, the teaching in a more pastoral way, in a more fatherly way. That conversation will be with me forever. I think That's again one of the things that I will take from here. It's the experiences and the many conversations I had with Monsignor. He's been a great mentor for me during these 2 years. Seeing him, seeing how he interacts with the parishioners, seeing how he answers to different challenges and requests from people, how he handled, with the help of many in the parish, this pandemic situation, how to answer to the needs of the people but keep people safe. I will forever treasure that, and I think I will be calling him very often to seek advice on how to be a pastor, to be a father for many people. Well, life at the rectory with Monsignor, Father Jim, and Kong was always fun. Always fun. I remember us gathering almost every day for supper. That will be kind of the meal that we will kind of share together, and just listen to the stories that all of them had to share. Listening to the stories that Monsignor had to share, I always laughed at the many things that he had to share with us, with Kong, with Father Jim, and I. Having Kong this past year has been a great blessing as well, because I myself was a seminarian, and I myself enjoyed and benefited from these pastoral experiences, these kind of internships in different places. Although I didn't have to take a pastoral year like Kong did, there are differences in different vocational processes. But Kong has been a great asset for us at the rectory and for the community. He's always making sure we're well fed. He cooks well, and he was always feeding us noodles. Father Jim was always so joyful with that contagious laughing that he has. I remember once when he was putting over there the Christmas ornaments and the Christmas tree and his many nativity scenes. I was, helping put those ornaments on the Christmas tree, and it looked so beautiful. But I remember I was out of the parish for a couple of days, and then Monsignor told me that the tree had failed. And I felt so bad because, some of those ornaments are so beautiful and so precious that some of them got damaged. But we, again, even in things like that, we looked at things with kind of a positive eye, and hey, it just felt nothing we could do. Maybe make sure it doesn't fall the next time. Kong, actually, there's a memory with Kong that it always makes me laugh. And Kong was making lunch one day. He was cooking a delicious noodle soup, which I love. And he finished cooking. He had things ready. He called me to have lunch. We said our prayer. He had he tasted it first, and then he said, "Oh, so good. I am so proud of myself." And I was like, "Okay, that's that's how humility goes away." Like, but very good, Kong. I said, "Absolutely, you're absolutely right. It's so delicious." But it almost, every time I eat noodles, I remember Kong saying that, how proud he was of himself for such a delicious meal. So, yeah. I had one experience like visiting one of our parishioners who had died, and just going to their home and being there with them and for them and giving the sacraments. It was the first time that I had to go after I came here to St. Francis to a home. The body of the deceased was still there in the house. We said some prayers. But it was a difficult moment because I hadn't had that experience before of like going to a place and being there with the family while the deceased person is still there. It was difficult because at first I just felt overwhelmed by the situation. I didn't know how to handle it. But then the warmth again of the family and how welcoming they were, it just made it so easy that in the end we just sat and they start sharing stories about their loved one. And you know, I was trying to give encouragement, reminding them of the gift of our faith and how that precious, how precious that gift is for us. But I will say that was one of the most difficult moments in the parish, yeah, for me. Okay, one of the funniest things it happened to me while I was here in the parish was the time that I had the Mass. I think it was a weekend Mass. And before that Mass, I used to have a beard. And after the Mass, that day, I just walked in and, okay, I said, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, the Mass started. But when the homily started, I start by saying, yes, I know, you know, I shaved. And people just start laughing. And I showed how, you know, because of an accident, I had to shave everything. So I looked like a 12-year-old altar server there. So it was so funny. People thought it was very funny. And people reacted to it very positively. So I think that was one of the funniest. And I still remember that day when people, I shared that memory with them. Not that memory, that thing that happened to me and how, yes, you know, I had a big beard before and now I don't have it anymore. What happened to you, Father? And some people liked it. You know, some people liked that I didn't have a beard anymore. Other people were like, oh, we miss it. I said, well, I'll come back. But I think that was it was a funny moment for me, yeah. I have many expectations now that I'm going to Edenton. And one of the greatest expectations that I have is to be able to walk with the community there. That's my purest and most sincere desire. I want to go there not as a little prince who is now kind of in charge of things and running the show, not with that mentality, knowing that I am a father, that I am a priest, that I am called to serve the people, to nurture their life, to nurture their journeys of faith, to help them have a deep and meaningful encounter with the Lord and with our faith, to re-fall in love with their faith, to rekindle that desire to be disciples. That's what I want to, that's my desire as I get ready to go to Edenton. I want to be a priest who is present. I want to be a priest who is accessible and close to the people. I want to be a faithful priest to what the church teaches, which is beautiful. You know, our faith is so beautiful and has so many layers and so many different shades, if I can say, but to be able to give that to them in an honest way, and to work hard for their salvation. I remember actually something that I heard a priest say when I think it was his first kind of weekend Mass at the parish. I was there for that transition when he came. And he said, my mission here is to make sure you guys get to heaven or die trying. That is what I want to do as well. I want to work hard so that the people of there, of Edenton, that parish, and have a deep encounter with the Lord. And you know, and they grow in the experience of faith. Yeah. Well, some final words to all of you, my dear friends, my dear brothers and sisters in the faith, as I get ready to go to Edenton, is please know how grateful I am for the gift of your faith, for the gift of who you are. You know, our Bishop Sarama always speaks of that, you know, the gift of who we are for each other. And you were truly, truly a gift for me, a blessing for me in my life. I came again. This is my first parish assignment. When I came here, I wasn't sure if this was a place that would welcome me, that would accept me. I am, from another country. I may have an accent. I was fearful that people will complain, that they could not understand me, that they could not relate to me. But I never felt out of place in this parish. I never felt unwelcomed and unloved by you. Even when you were dealing with the pandemic, even when you were dealing with the parish being kind of closed and, you know, having, you know, limited access to many things here in the parish, even when you were kind of missing that opportunity of saying goodbye to the Franciscan friars as a community that was taking care of all of you for so many years, even when that was true, and even when your hearts were aching because of that, you never made us feel, unwelcome and loved. You said, welcome to the parish. Here we are. We're here for you. Tell us, how can we help you? How can we assist you in many ways? So I am so much grateful for that opportunity. I thank you again for your witness of faith, for your love, for the passion you have for the gospel, for the passion you have for those who are in need in our midst. I will take you, all of you, with me in my heart to Edenton. And I ask you for your prayers as I get ready to embark in this exciting new mission that the Lord has given me. And I pray that I may be a shepherd according to the heart of our Lord Jesus. A shepherd that loves, a shepherd that encourages, a shepherd that helps heal, you know, the wounds of the sheep, and a shepherd that smells like the sheep that he's tending to. So love you all. I love you very, very much. And thank you for, I want to take the opportunity to thank you for those of you who had the opportunity to come to the farewell party, for your many words, for the gifts you gave me, for your hugs, for all those memories. I will always treasure them in my heart. Thank you very much, everyone.